All right, so now we're going to talk for a minute about the apportionment system. And Dennis, could you speak to whether the system is designed to allow people or conferences to designate givings for specific funds? And I would say that one of the things we get asked that a lot is.
Well, I'm going to treat the specific funds as the seven general funds that support the general church. And plus, we also have the jurisdictional funds that we worry about as well. But the conference has near total control over that, at least at their level.
At least most
conferences have near total control over that at their own level. Many conferences budget that money into their budgets, and then they make a decision as to how much of that is going to be supported and paid by them. Legacy Rocky Mountain, Legacy Yellowstone, paid 100% of their general and jurisdictional apportionments for many years as part of our DNA as to who we are. But that having been said, some conferences now, our Mountain Sky is one of those, is that we're now moving to a place where we're transferring that authority to the local church. We are giving a number to the local church as to what their share is of the general and jurisdictional apportionment, and we're even telling them what the subcomponents are for those eight funds, and we're going to allow them to make that decision. So the question is it at the conference level, do they have control? Yes, they do, absolutely. The further you move from the conference level, the more people have to operate with greater intentionality as to how they do that. For example, if the trust is not high at a local church and they're concerned that the World Service Fund is not being supported at the level they want it to be, they always have the option of sending resources directly to the World Service Fund here in Nashville. They could do that if they want to. Individuals could have the same authority if they wanted to do that as well.
And I'd just like to add in, and Dennis and I talked about this earlier, I think designated giving is a slippery slope. And we need to balance the rights of donors, and donors should have the right to give to what they want to give to. We need to keep that in mind. But the flip side of that is, and Christine talked about this, there's this process where you have lots of people involved in deciding how you're going to spend the money. And when you allow people to start designating, either at the individual level or at the church level, what they're going to give to, it takes the place of that collective wisdom and collective input of what we need to do as a church and what we've decided through the input of many people by allowing the donors to decide what you're going to spend your money on and what your budget is, as opposed to the process. And I think that's something that we have to, it's a healthy tension that we need to keep out there. If everybody wanted to designate what they give their money to in every church, then you don't need budgets anymore. And you don't have the ability to do things long term. And who's going to designate their money to pay to the electric company? I mean, you know, there's some things that are not as exciting as others to designate to. And so I think we have to be very careful with designated giving.
I was the chairman of the board for a nonprofit in Colorado Springs, which helped people in need, primarily helped them with utility bills and helped them with clothing and rent assistance. And everybody wanted to designate their offering so that it went directly to a person in need. But we still have to pay the executive director. We still had to pay for the people doing the development of the resources. And we got to a place in about 2002, 2003, where we had plenty of resources to give away, but we didn't have anybody to administer it. And that's exactly what John is talking about. You've got to be very careful. It works okay if 5% of the people do it. It starts to really break down when 95% of the people want to do it. It doesn't work then.
Christine, could you talk about how we describe apportionment? Some people have referred to it as a tax. Others say you should look at it as a subscription service like Netflix. Is either of those terms appropriate?
At the annual conference, we've certainly heard those terms. So we've heard, you know, the tax, we've heard the subscription service, we've heard the dues, we've heard franchise fees, we've heard all kinds of names attached to that. And in my opinion, as I've gone through and been with local churches when we've talked about that and tried to help them understand the apportionment process and connectional giving in general, what I found out is that when churches begin to understand the way that money is used, those names fall away. because they begin to understand that this is right. the way that we are in connectional ministry. So those are ministry dollars. They're not a Netflix subscription that you pay and then you receive something back. You don't give with that intention of receiving back. You give because God first gave to you. And that's why you give to support the ministry of Jesus Christ, and you give to support that, the connection and the way that we do ministry globally, that we're all over the place doing ministry. So we give with that intention that we give to ministry versus I give so that I receive something. So I don't find those descriptors to be accurate, though I understand why. If you didn't understand the way we do budgeting or the apportionment system or the connection or the right. family, because we as a connection, we're the family of the United Methodist Church. Right. And when we don't understand our ministry family, then I understand why it may appear that way. But I don't find that to be accurate. And I have observed as I've met with churches and they've come to understand the way that we fund the ministry of our family, of our Methodist family, that those terms do tend to fall away.
And I'd like to add, I agree 100% with what you just said. It's all about educating people and understanding what it's used for. But my frustration is with the term apportion. I think using that term puts you in a negative light before you get started, before you get to the education. We've used an accounting, only in the Methodist Church, we've used an accounting term that's a verb to apportion. Mm-hmm. And we've turned it into a noun and we call it apportionments. And so the wording and the language we use to people that don't understand all the things that you're talking about immediately sends you into these negative places that don't speak to the fact that it's about mission and ministry, and those dollars are used to help people make a difference in their lives throughout the world. And I'm on a personal mission to get us to quit using that term. I don't have any expectation that I'll ever win that. But if we wouldn't use the term to apportion, and we would use terms that describe what it is, like ministry shares or connectional commitments or whatever terms we could use that are more descriptive of what it actually is, the things that Christine was talking about, we wouldn't have to start the educational process by getting over the term. And that's the part that I think we put ourselves in a bad spot to begin with.
Well, as a journalist, we always like more accessible terms too. So
terms.
You also like terms that are accepted across the, in our right. case, across the connection. And so the word apportionment is understood across the connection, even though I agree with John about the comment about verbs and nouns. It's an accounting term.
Right.
And you hear all kinds of terms of expressing how it might be an alternative. Mountain Sky, we've experimented with connectional giving. Mm-hmm. We've experimented with mission shares. I would say that it would be good for us if once we decide how we're going to call it, let's call it that for a long time.
Agreed. In my conference, we use share giving.
Okay.
Share giving, and it's the same. The concept helps to understand what is the purpose. I agree with you.
Okay. How does the apportioned dollar break down in terms of the money that stays in the annual conference and the money that goes to general church ministries?
Well, I'll offer in North Carolina, out of every dollar that's given in the local church, 88% of that stays within the local church, and that's based on our statistical table reporting. 88% stays in the local church. Then of the remaining 12%, 3% of that comes to the general agency, and the rest remains with the annual conference, for the annual conference ministries.
Are there repercussions for not paying apportionments?
Of course, it stops the opportunities of reaching out to others and seeing being part of the big mission of the church. That means that we will not reach out as many or as much when we have less resources. And I think that it's important for us as a pastor, our role as a pastor, to motivate people to be part of the giving. And I would like to for you to, Christine, to mention the survey that you did in your annual conference. It would be good to share that with us.
Sure. Well, it wasn't a study we did in North Carolina, but it was a study done by a conference treasurer that has retired now. So this person has retired, and it was several years ago, but in their annual conference, what they found out was, as they looked at giving trends in local churches, and then also following those giving trends for pastors, what they found out was in that annual conference were the pastors that were at churches that paid 100% consistently, when that pastor moved to another church, was reappointed, if that pastor was appointed to a church that generally paid less than 100%, in about 2 or 3 years, that church was back up to 100%. And also, likewise, if the pastor generally was at a church that paid less than 100%, and that pastor was reappointed to a church that paid 100%, within 2 or 3 years, that church would drop below 100%. So the numbers, it wasn't a scientific study, but it was detailed information in that annual conference. Then what that found then was that that giving trend tends to follow the pastor. So it tends to follow the leadership as that leadership moves from one church to another. That's not in every case, but as a trend, it does tend to follow that pastor. So it reinforces that the importance then, what Lisette was saying, it reinforces the importance of that pastoral leadership in giving that very clear direction of why we do what we do in the connectional church, why we are connectional, how are we a family, how do we do ministry together and live into that. That follows, in general, from that study, the pastor. And I'll offer that my observation from our annual conference as well is that it does tend to follow that. So it's important for our clergy and our lay leadership as well in local churches to pay attention to what they're saying, how they're promoting connectional giving, how are they talking about that when they're telling the story of the connectional giving in the local church, because the church is listening. There are ways that church will follow the direction there of that look, of that pastor in that setting. So it's important that our pastoral leadership then pay attention and learn more so that they can help to educate people about the way we do ministry in the United Methodist Church.